Hey everybody! On here again, and to be honest, I am quite depressed. I have had a fucking terrible day at work. Tomorrow promises to be an even bigger shit sandwich. And I am just kind of feeling old and busted without really any place that I belong in the world these days. So, yeah. Excuse me if I'm a little bit subdued and a little off my game. But I do hope you will follow along with me as I try to cheer myself up by repeatedly committing the murder act against acceptable targets in Dark Souls 2, Scholar of the First Sin. And we shall begin by sliding on down here into the fire pit area of the Forest of Fallen Giants. And we'll get ourselves back to that fog gate we previously encountered. And we will proceed onward. Yeah, this guy is just really no good at playing possum. Dude, it helps if you lie down all the way and stop moving. Oh, but he dropped something very nice for us. This is actually a pretty sweet weapon. I think the flaming sword is probably a better overall choice at this point in my life, but the bastard sword's really pretty good, and these guys don't drop it very often. Oh, wow. Actually, that's a step up from even the flaming sword, although... Well, when we factor the fire damage in, maybe not. But if nothing else, it's going to make a quality secondary weapon. Certainly better than our Morning Star, although it doesn't, of course, have the bleed buildup. Oh, actually, I can't use that correctly right now. My strength is not quite enough. So we'll put that off for the time being, stick with the Morning Star, and just keep our current loadout, but you know what? That actually cheers me up a little right away. Because that is a good weapon, and it would be a little while before I could get access to it if that guy hadn't kindly dropped it for us. I don't think I've ever seen that guy drop a bastard sword. It's, perhaps a rather rare drop. Oh! Shit. Yeah, that's one thing you should know about this area that you come into after the fog gate. It is just chock full of snipers. There are dudes with bows everywhere. But what we want to do first is attract the attention of the guy with the axe who was standing on the platform across the way there. If you get his attention, he'll fall down, climb up that ladder, and drop off right here, just like you saw. But yeah, this area with all the scaffolding can be a little frustrating for first-time players because there are just people shooting bows at you from all over creation. But we are going to get our revenge on them in fairly short order. Well, that is not at all what I was trying to do, but we'll take it for the moment. I was just trying to drop down there. Didn't actually mean to get on this platform here. But, on the bright side... Oh, hello. Thought I heard a dude coming after me. Alright, we'll take it slow. And down this way, we can get a treasure a little earlier than I planned to. Titanite shard. Those are always good things to get for free this early in the game. Hey, jerk. Come on, pull your knife out and come out here and fight properly. That's better. Now then, back to what I was trying to do, which is make my way to the snipers and gradually take them out. First up, I think I will... That's more like it. Didn't mean to take that little bit of falling damage there, but that's not going to kill me. If I keep getting shot, it will, though. Now then, if we make our way over here... And down here, we can get a moment's reprieve in the cave here. Stop to heal up. up the ladder, and we can take out another sniper or two. This little drop here is a one-way trip, but that's okay. We can always work our way around the long way. That's satisfying. I agree. Hurrah for revenge. That's kind of a nice view, isn't it? Alright. Now, this time, I'm going to make that jump again. We'll get that other guy in just a bit. But first of all... Well, actually, I think there's an item in that tree trunk that I'm gonna want. But you know what? We'll come back for that. First, let's go this way. And you'll want to be careful, because there's a boulder right there. But, we've avoided death, and we get a free human effigy, so... Hooray for boulder. And there's nothing actually here but a death pit. Treasure ahead is a filthy lie. Jumping and then death, on the other hand, is quite accurate. That doesn't have any purpose other than to give the boulder a place to, fall. And now if we head up this tunnel, we will meet a new friend. Be wary of left. Do we have an enemy here? Oh yeah, it's that other sniper. Well, we can get our revenge on him at least. And an amber herb. Not that I'll be a big spellcaster, but they're nice to have around. Well, let's say hello to our new buddy. Well, actually, let's see what this message says. Yeah, he is kind of leaving his tuchus exposed there. But we don't care about that. We're here to make conversation.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was just daydreaming, I think. My name is Kale. I'm a traveler, like yourself. I'm navigating the continent to create a map. Why cartography, you ask? Well, that's a good question. When I first came to this forsaken land, it was... a curse? Something about a curse? How embarrassing. I seem to have lost my focus. But I do know one thing for certain. I have always been very fond of maps.
Ah, poor Kale. He seems to be starting to hollow a bit, perhaps. He still looks all right, but his memory seems to be escaping him.
I came to this land some time ago. Drangling, the Lost Kingdom. It sounded so romantic. Have you seen Majula? Well, there's a rather spacious mansion there. I've made it my temporary home. Well, as something of a squatter, I'm afraid. Inside the mansion, I found a strange map, like none I'd ever seen. I believe that it's a map of Drenlek. Now I'm traveling the land to prove it. Yes. Yes, that's it. That's why I came to the kingdom. Wait. No. That wasn't it. Then what? I don't seem to recall.
Your curse, dude? The dark sign? The whole being an undead thing? That's why most of us end up in Drenlek.
Were you looking for that map? Wonderful. Then you're fascinated by maps, just like me. Shame on you. You should have told me before. Here, take this. A key to the mansion.
Hooray! A house key.
What a joy to meet a kindred spirit out here.
Well, yeah, we're fascinated by maps, totally. Let's just go with that.
Incredible, really, isn't it? Such a map to be chiseled in stone. Oh, but one thing. I would not venture deep into the mansion. I can't be certain, but I've heard disturbing noises. Something about it feels wrong. Just be careful, please.
So, we now have a key to the biggest building in Majula. On the downside, there are apparently creepy noises coming out of it. Oh well, still worth exploring.
I'll be back in Majula soon. Perhaps we will meet again, and discuss maps at our leisure.
It's a date. Kale is just gonna hang out here and not actually move into Majula until we defeat our first boss, much like, the merchant hag Malentia. But we can go back and explore the mansion now that we have the key. In fact, let's take a look at that. In the past, Majula served as a dumping ground for horrible things, but is now a gathering place for those with no better place to go. It seems this house in Majula was the final home for a few such souls. And just because I don't think we looked at it earlier, Lenegrast Key. Majula, the land of exiles, is comprised of abandoned old houses, one of which Lenegrast has fashioned into a workshop. Well, that's pretty straightforward. Alright, now I'm gonna tempt fate a little and try and jump to the roof over there. Oh, just made it. Where the fuck did you come from? I don't remember there usually being a dude down there. Of course, that could just be my memory betraying me. It's very good at doing that. Maybe he tried to follow me a bit and landed down there. I don't know. In any case, I want to go into that tree trunk that's over to the right and pick up whatever's there. I know there's some kind of treasure down there on a corpse, but I don't remember exactly what it is. So we'll find out together. I should be able to just slide in over here. Kind of walking on air for a moment there. And it's just a torch. But as we've discussed before, torch time is in fairly short supply earlier in the game, so it's worth having some extra. Where was that guy with the bow? To be honest, I kind of lost track of him. Oh well. Oh, there he is. And this ought to be enough to take him out. As long as my aim is... Oh, nice dodge! Now don't you do that again. There we go. Alright, well we've got a shiny new key, and we've got what I believe should be enough souls for a level up, so before we go any deeper, I'm just gonna roll on back and... explore that new mansion. So back we go to the convenient bonfire. All right. Bearer seek, seek lest. And we are definitely going to need more strength, both for that great shield that Malin the Armorer has over there, and for that bastard sword, which I would like to get a little use out of, so we'll go ahead and drop a strength. At this point in the game, there are a lot of stats that we badly need, including stamina and vitality and whatnot, but we're definitely going to need lots and lots of strength in the long run, so I'm just taking it while I can. And while I'm in the neighborhood, I'll pick up a few extra souls from our buddy Lenegrast here. Not souls, arrows. What am I talking about?
Oh, I'd given you up for dead. Almost had me worried, really.
Ah, that's sweet of you, Lenny.
I'll be around if you make it back.
Oh, I'll always be back, Lenegrast. Even after the many, many stupid deaths I will inevitably suffer. Well, someone's quite a bibliophile. A big bibliophile. And a free Pharos's Lockstone. That's always good to find. You may recall I mentioned in a previous episode that Pharos Lockstones are used to activate various contraptions, some of which are traps, but most of which are quite beneficial. Now down there is where we would find the stone map that Kale was so excited about, but let's explore the rest of the mansion before we go there. Hey, hey, we've got a chest. No latches on it, which means it's safe. Some free titanite and some free torches. Again, very useful stuff early in the game. So I have no complaints. And here we just have a nice rooftop view of no particular value. What am I saying? A nice rooftop view has intrinsic value. And what we have here is what appears to be a remarkably stupid place for a window. I think there's only really one thing to say about this. Gorgeous view. Fine work. Moving along, here is Kale's map. But Kale himself has not come along yet. He'll be joining us here in Majula after we have fought our first boss. Chest ahead, but impossible. I like that, because it's not actually a chest that you can open. I see what they did there. Now, it's not really a tough enemy, but the plethora of bloodstains down here indicate that we do have an enemy ahead of us, which is presumably the source of those creepy sounds Kale had been hearing. So, we will proceed with caution, but we will proceed. And it's a skeleton. Indeed a little tougher than the average early game enemy, but nothing we can't handle. Oh, you got a piece of me. There we go. And a free effigy for our trouble. Seems like a good trade. Now then, over here we have some more treasure. Our very first soul vessel. And the soul vessel is the item that allows us to respec. Which I discussed previously. It converts all of your levels back into souls, and so you can level up in a new way and kind of give yourself a new character playing style. Which, as I've mentioned, I will probably do when I go to New Game Plus. First time through, I'll just play the game the way I normally do. And an Estus Flask Shard. Now that was definitely worth coming here for. There's something else I would like to show you down here, but I would like to bring a torch and light that sconce, so we will deal with that after I cash in this Estus Flask Shard. Oh yeah, It occurs to me there's a thing in the tent over here that I never actually remembered to pick up. Just a life gem, but every little bit counts. And as you can see, just by picking up another 4 torches, we have extended our torch time to a little over 25 minutes. So, like I mentioned before, your torch time tends to build up pretty fast, and by the end of the game, I am pretty sure I will have a lot more than I know what to do with. Let's light up this brazier, and we'll keep our torch handy. And here is something very surprising. If you compare it to the way it looked in Dark Souls 1, this appears to be the remnants of the Lord Vessel. How it got into the basement here, I don't know. I suppose it's always possible that it isn't the true Lord Vessel. Maybe it's just like Grandma's commemorative replica Lord Vessel hanging planter or something. But I like to think this is some more evidence that this Dranglaic Kingdom is either where Lordran used to be, or at least in the same geographical area that Lordran used to be in. There's other evidence for this throughout the game, but it's never explicitly confirmed or denied. I, for one, do subscribe to the theory that Dranglaic is in, or at least near, the site of the now vanished land of Lordran. For my money, there's just too much to suggest that that's the case. And perhaps I'll make that case to you over the course of my playthrough. Perhaps I won't. Either way, just glad to have you along. But enough of that for now. We're heading back to the Forest of Fallen Giants. Hopefully to make some good progress with a minimum of mishap. Back down the hole once again. And I do like to take out minor enemies repeatedly as I go, because something I don't believe I've discussed before is that Dark Souls 2, in one of its other controversial changes from the original Dark Souls, has a respawn cap for most enemies. Actually, for pretty much all enemies, I think. The number of respawns they can do varies from enemy type to enemy type. Usually, I think it's somewhere around a dozen, maybe a bit more. But yeah, if you keep going back to bonfires, then enemies will eventually just stop respawning as long as you keep killing them. A lot of people don't like this for two reasons. One, it lets you brute force the game. If you just keep dying over and over again, you can eventually cut through all of the enemy's respawns. And also, it makes it hard to farm for items in case you're trying to get some particular rare drops. On the other hand, it can be a nice anti-frustration feature. If you keep dying to a particular boss, eventually you can cut out all the minor enemies between you and that boss. It's a double-edged sword, and I really don't have any strong feelings one way or the other. But that's another thing that makes a lot of people not like Dark Souls 2 as much as they did the original. You can get around this to some extent with bonfire aesthetics. You may recall I talked about those a bit when talking about starting gifts. Bonfire aesthetics, if you don't recall, allow you to toss them into a bonfire and make that bonfire the equivalent of a new level of New Game Plus. And that also resets the resets the spawn counters. Anyway, enough of that. We've got an ironclad here, and you want to be careful fighting them near these exploding barrels because their big iron hammers can set off the explosions, but you can make that work to your advantage. I'll try and show that off here. First, we'll get his attention, get him to swing on me. revenge. Oh! Got a piece of me, too, which isn't quite what I intended, but, whatever. For demonstrative purposes, I suppose it still serves well enough. Oh well. Is that guy gonna try and come back up here? No, he's just gonna stand there like a lemon, and I'm going to stand there like a lemon and get shot. Yay for me. Boss ahead, sort of. What we have up there is a rather powerful enemy, who is also a one-shot enemy. When you fight him, either you win, you run away, or you die. Either way, he's gone and will never return. Fighting him at this point in the game probably wouldn't work out real well for me, so I'm gonna leave him alone for the moment. He has real good defense, which the fire sword would help with somewhat, but still, I can't help but think, oh yeah, firebomb guy. I can't help but think I would come out on the ass end. I don't like you, so I'm gonna shoot you in the head. Oh, do I not have arrows equipped? I don't have arrows equipped. That's no good. There we go. Now ahead of me here, you will see a damaged-looking wall with some explosive barrels in front of it. You can actually bait the firebomb guy here into throwing his firebomb at one of those barrels and blowing them up for you. But that's a little riskier than I feel like screwing around with right now. So I'm just gonna use the DIY ethic. I think this should be more or less correct aim, so let's give it a try. Perfect! And now we have a nice handy shortcut right back to our bonfire. Whoops. Messed up my timing a bit there. Won't be the first, won't be the last time. So what I'm gonna do is get my Estus refilled, get my weapon repaired, and then I'm going to head up to that platform and give it the old college try. I do not expect that I will win the fight up there, but that's okay. There isn't really a huge reward even if you do it successfully, and even if I lose, I can go back up there, recover my souls, and then I will be able to get the treasure that's up there, which is definitely worth collecting. Before any of that stuff, though, I'm gonna gain another level.
Is that it? Here, let me see it, to see light, however faint it might be.
Yep, forgot to cash in my Estus Flask Shard earlier. Accidentally skipped the dialogue there, but we'll get another chance to run it through. More power. And as before, I'm going to spend the dregs on some extra ammunition. Damn it, Lenegrast. I know you're starting to hollow, but you don't need to be that forgetful. You give me up for dead every time I come by. Always do. I do not like firebomb guy here, so I'm gonna get him out of the way. Go. We'll have a spear guy come up for us. Take him out as well. Got a little careless with my stamina there. Gotta be careful with these things. Alright, let's get rid of our, Oh, shit! That's right. Flaming swords are on fire. It really helps to remember that. Ah, screw it. I'm just going back to the bonfire. Yeah, typically, regular old sword slashes will not, blow up explosive barrels. But when your sword is on fire, yeah, that does kind of happen. Oh, well. Live, learn, remember, remind. Shoot over the head of your target. Life's funny that way. At least I made a slightly better showing of Spear Guy. Hey, dude. I'm just gonna stand there? Well, I sucked down an arrow, but at least I got to one-shot him. We'll call that worth it. Hey, Ironclad. Got a present for you. Oh, you're supposed to swing at it, dude. Oh well, at least you're still easy to bait and punish. Alright. Now we can have our proper and most likely doomed duel with the gentleman up here. There's gonna be a hollow in the back corner there. I want to take him out quick so I don't have to fight multiple enemies along with the boss here. Well, the sort of boss who flies in on a nice big bird. Oh shit. Right. Ladies and gentlemen, meet the pursuer. Oops, I didn't actually mean to hit the button there. Oh, shit! Yeah, that glowing blue sword there, that is unblockable, and I have been cursed. Which is different from a curse in the regular game. Also, that now powered the pursuer up, so I'm doubly punished. And I've been killed. Awesome. I don't think that even counts as a proper college try. Our first death. A brave one, but not a good showing. So, let's talk about cursing and hollowing. Works a little bit different from the previous Dark Souls. For one, you can still be invaded while you're hollow. So it is not a guaranteed protection from PvP. Although I think you're somewhat less likely to be found for an invasion. When you go hollow, you lose a little bit of your max HP. If you look at my HP bar up in the upper left there, you will notice that it maxes out a little below where it should. A little bit of it is cut off. That is actually 2 degrees of reduction, because the curse, unlike Dark Souls 1, where it instantly killed you and reduced your max HP by half, cursing in Dark Souls 2 just means you die without actually dying. That is to say, you don't lose your souls, you don't get kicked back to the bonfire, but you do become hollow on the spot. So, this is 2 degrees of hollowing thanks to the curse and the proper death. So, kind of a bummer. We're now rather shriveled and unpleasant looking. But at least we get to raid the pursuer's platform for his goodies. The pursuer, by the way, is someone we'll be seeing a lot of over the course of the game. He doesn't actually pursue you, per se. He has defined spawn points. But he does show up quite a few times, and we'll have definitely our share of battles with him. Especially in one particular area where there are a bunch of pursuer spawn points. Most of them are normal spawns. That is to say, they're not strictly one-time like this. But he doesn't respawn, at least. Hey, dude. Oh, I keep knocking him off without actually killing him. Not my intention. Okay, Ironclad. That's what I wanted! That is always so satisfying. And it leaves them mostly dead, so it's convenient too. Alright, up here we go. I will want to get rid of the hollow here. And mind his friends, which he has two of. Oh, watch that stamina. Oh shit. That went a little bit wrong. Spear guys are a little bit more aggressive in Dark Souls 2 than they were in the original, but they do still like to turtle up from time to time, so you do want to be ready with a guard break. And that's why I came up here, an Estus Flask Shard. And there are a few other niceties as well, although nothing quite as exciting. A little extra time for our torch. Free effigy and some life gems, that's no bad thing. Especially now that we're hollow. And repair powder, which is fairly rare, and when you can actually buy it, it's pretty expensive. So, good stuff all around. By the way, it is not strictly necessary to use a human effigy in order to reverse your hollowing. You can co-op and fulfill your duty either by running out your summon timer or defeating the boss with a friend in jolly cooperation. I prefer to do that whenever possible because that way you don't have to use up one of your valuable human effigies, and also co-oping boss fights is a good way to get some extra spending money. So let's cash in our flask shard, and I'll not skip the dialogue this time.
Is that a shard you found? Here, let me see it, so that I may help you. To see light, to see hope, however faint it might be.
And that's our fourth shot of refreshing Sunny D. Very good to have. And we've got enough for another level. That's also a good thing. We'll keep bumping that strength up toward the magic 20 number, and then we'll focus some more on endurance and other valuable things. Thank you, ma'am. I wasn't here even all that long ago, Lenny. I'll pick up one of his 10 Titanite shards here. And just a bit more ammunition.
I'll be around.
I'll make it back, I promise. Actually, no, I don't want to go that way. I want to use our new shortcut. And killing off that ironclad again is always good for the soul collection. Along with the various hollows that we have here. Gotta be careful, I almost hit that barrel there, which, as you've seen, is kind of bad if you have a fire sword. Why don't you pull out your knife and get a little closer so I can kill you proper this time. Hey there, Mr. Ironclad. Why don't you have a swing on me and... Nope, do one of your sideways swings. There we go. Oh! I got a little bit of that, but still lets me kill this guy quicker, so I'll accept. And now let us continue our explorations down this way. First off, another halberd guy. We can just blitz him. And a shiny. Now we've got a couple directions we can explore at this point. There's that suspiciously ballista-encrusted opening there. Could go this way. But first of all, let's have a chat with this fellow sitting over here on the sandbags.
Hello there. Traveling all alone in these treacherous times. Well, I hope you have a very good reason. Oh, hogwash. Who am I to judge? My name is Pate. I journey hither and thither on a sort of treasure hunt, you might call it. Be careful out there. There's talk of unsavory bandits who prey upon travelers like yourself.
Oh, this Pate seems like a fine gentleman, doesn't he? Pleased to meet you, sir.
Oh, yes. You be cautious if you go any farther. There's treasure in there for certain, but the entrance locks from behind. I saw the same design earlier, and it's the same contraption, I'm sure. I was with this warrior, you see, and he insisted that he go inside first. The rather brusque fellow tried to swipe the loot for himself, but it trapped him inside. I still have the gent's ring. I do hope he wasn't harmed. I'll leave this one to you. I'm worried about what might be inside.
Well, that's fair enough. There are some nice things to find if we go this way, but as Pate warned, the gate will close behind us, which will make it somewhat difficult to recover our souls if we get killed in there. And because there are a number of hollows on the other side of that gate, getting killed in there is a distinct possibility. So I'm going to hold off on that for the moment. However, Scots! The fuck? I do beg your pardon. I absolutely must light these at every possible opportunity. Ah, always satisfying. Now then, I think for our next stop, we're gonna peek our head in there. And as you may have guessed, it is a trap. We are going to draw the fire of pretty much every one of those ballistae. But if we peek our heads in and then quickly hurry out, we should be safe. Some enemies will chase after us, but hopefully I can take them all out without too much mishap. And at least that guy got shot. Alright, come on out, shooting friends. Watch that stamina. Alright, well, we got the kills. That's the important thing for the immediate. Not bad, not bad. Alright, I think there might be another dude or two in here, so I will move with caution. And it is a little bit dark as well. And we can fire these ballista as well. We can't actually aim them, but we can fire them in the direction that they're aimed. And we get a free copy of Great Soul Arrow, which is probably going to require more intelligence than we'll ever actually have, but hey, something for the collection. And a consumable soul and a blue wooden shield. Let's take a look at some of those new goodies, since it doesn't seem like anything's going to attack us right away. The blue wooden shield is inferior to metal shields in terms of stability and physical damage reduction, but easy to use and weighing so little that it hardly requires any strength to bear. Well, we got lots of strength, so that's not really our style. As for Great Soul Arrow, a spell superior to the Soul Arrow. More powerful and effective at damaging enemies resistant to physical attacks. The strength of this spell is influenced by one's intelligence, as most sorcery is. Now let's see, is there another sconce in here I can light up to mitigate the dark a bit? I thought there might be, but perhaps my memory is betraying me. Is there anyone down here? Negative. Good. Oh! Poison trap! If you roll away, usually when you see that green cloud, you can usually get far enough away that you won't catch the full brunt of the poison and won't actually be poisoned. Which is good, because poison in Dark Souls 2 is much worse than it was in 1. Poison is about as bad as Dark Souls Toxic was, and Toxic in this game is even worse. A Titanite Shard is not particularly exciting treasure for, so early in the... or for a trap chest, rather, but as I was starting to say there, so early in the game, it's still nice to have. And I did see another brazier down there, so I must do what I must do. It'll help cut through the gloom a little bit. It is good to have some visibility. And now we can more clearly see what is our very first Pharaoh's contraption. And into that, we will insert one of our Pharaoh's lockstones. And just stick the keystone in the mouth there. And what have we here? A glowing blue face. And you can attack that and open a secret door. Now, you do have to activate the contraption. It doesn't just point the way, it actually makes it possible to destroy this wall. So, if you know it's already here, you can't get away with just smashing your way through without using a lockstone. But once you have used the lockstone, you will find they have helpfully concealed some chests here. No latches on these, they are safe. And we get our first Titanite slab. Actually, no, that's not our first Titanite slab, because I had quite forgotten we got one earlier from Dinah and Tillo. And, as I think I mentioned at the time, Dark Souls 2 is really generous with the slabs. We will actually get quite a lot of them. Hurrah for ring! Yes, as a matter of fact, what we will find in here is a very nice ring to have. The Chloranthi ring. Just like Dark Souls 1, it increases our stamina regeneration speed. It's actually not as good as it was in Dark Souls 1, but it's still good, and we have ring slots to spare with nothing else in them, so why not? And one other thing in the dark basement here, we have a rather tricky door. It's a neat gimmick here, although they only ever use it once. This is the only time you'll ever see this happen in the game. Well, first we'll try to open it, and we find that it doesn't open from this side. But the message here is very accurate. If we try attacking, make a little noise, then they'll open the door for us. I think I actually missed. There we go. There's a halberd. Okay, two halberd guys, one of which got a very nice hit on me. Credit where due. Ah, damn it. Oh, this is going bad for me. Yeah, just more evidence that fighting multiple enemies in Dark Souls 2 is always something to avoid whenever you can help it. But we'll use a little cover for our benefit there. The spear guy, at least, is usually not too aggressive. Well, that's one down. That'll help. The other one just has one hit left in him. Alright, spear guy, if you want to get aggressive, I'm not going to complain about it. On the other hand, if you're going to try and kill the shit out of me, that I do find objectionable. We're all out of the Sunny D, so we'll use the Sunny Stone. That's enough out of you. And that's enough out of you. Well, that went a little bit sour, but any battle you can walk away from, right? And for our trouble, we get one more treasure. Which is? Well, actually, two treasures. A large Titanite shard, and the Life Ring. The Life Ring does about what you'd expect. Gives you a little more maximum HP. Each ring has a different power, and even very modest rings can be a great boon on a perilous journey. Little wisdom from the flavor text. And we still have one ring slot that has nothing going on for it, so a little more HP. Never hurt anybody. And yet again, I believe I have passed the level up threshold, so back to Majula, back to the Far Fire, and back to the Emerald Herald. The beginning of Dark Souls 2 tends to be rather slow going because you start out so weak. You do a lot of back and forth, gradually building up your character and working your way through the Forest of Fallen Giants, or Hate's Tower of Flame, depending on where you've chosen to start your travels.
Bearer of the curse, seek, lest this...
But as we get stronger, we'll be able to push forward more and more at a time, and the game will start to move a little more swiftly. And we are almost up to that magic threshold of strength that will let us use both the Bastard Sword and the Twin Dragon Great Shield. Alright, we bought out all the Iron Arrows. I think I still haven't spent enough with Lenegras to get his frequent customer reward, but let's give it a try anyway.
You'll need souls to repair. I don't wait. I'll be around.
Yeah, I didn't think so. Alright, we're getting a little late in the day here, but we've got enough time to do a little more exploration, I think. You, as always, get arrows in the head. You, as always, are going to aggro from surprisingly far away. And also, as usual, we're gonna get rid of these guys. Because in the early game, getting the souls for fighting that ironclad is good for our collection. Let's see if we can get him to swing on. Yes, that's the good stuff. And I actually managed to avoid harm myself. Good deal. Well, it took a little harm from the hammer there, but... you know, these things will happen. Oh yeah, I forgot about this guy. Well, that problem will be swiftly remedied. This time, I think I'm going to head over this way. And this spot is a little bit dangerous because, as you can see, the area is absolutely carpeted with explosive barrels, and the two gentlemen up there in the windows, they're going to throw firebombs down here. So it can set off a great big chain explosion and really fuck your shit up. So I'm just going to snipe them and get them out of the way nice and early. If I can get my aim right, that is. That's good. I'll get this gentleman's attention from afar. We'll let him clear out some of the barrels, because if I do so with my flaming sword, well, we've seen how that ends up for me. And we know what this is. There's another area there that we can explore in just a little while into the next video, probably, but for now we're gonna go over this way and see something kind of interesting. No, you don't. Yes, you do. Now you don't. Now here's that interesting thing I was talking about. That tree there, that is one of the fallen giants. It is the remains of a giant who was killed in this spot. And we have some of the hollowed soldiers of Drang Lake just attacking the hell out of it. You may recall that Drang Lake was at war with the giants in the past. And we have a few of the kingdom's soldiers here, now gone hollow. And all they remember, apparently, in their hollowed out state is their battle with the giants. So they're just repeating their programming. I thought that was a real nice touch on the part of the developers. And it also gives us an easy kill, so hooray for that. And we can look at the fallen giant here, but nothing happens. There is, however, a little bit of loot on the other side. Gonna heal up just a bit to be safe. And up we go. And our first crossbow. As I've mentioned, crossbows are a good deal more useful in Dark Souls 2 than they were in the original, because if you hold them with both hands, you can do a sighted, aimed shot just like you can with a bow. Now, there are those windows that the guys with the firebombs were hanging out in. Fortunately, they're already dead. And that item over there, I honestly don't know how to get that, or what it is for that matter. It seems like the only way you could really get to it would be to jump across here, but that doesn't seem to be possible. At the very least, if it is possible, I can't get the jump timing right. So I'll give it a shot and show you what I mean. It doesn't seem like you can actually make that jump. And of course I immediately make it. What the fuck? Well, thanks, message. And it's a consumable and some extra torch time. Not too exciting, but worth having. And here's a guy with a thrusting sword. Haven't seen one of those before. Oh, shit, he can parry! Well, fortunately, seems a little too hollowed and strung out to actually take advantage of the riposte. So, whatever. See, that's my type of critical hit. And a helmet, which is pretty boring. And a mail breaker, which is also pretty boring, but at least it's unique. It has limited reach, but a powerful critical attack. Effective against foes donning thick armor, or with naturally hard skin. So you can use it to go through shields, and it's good for backstabbing, but... still not a very exciting weapon. Some people probably like it, but... not my style. If we fall on the cart there, I believe we can avoid taking any fall damage. Yep. Alrighty then. I'm going to save that sunsetty place for later. And we are soon going to want to explore beyond Pate's gateway trap there. But for now, it's been about an hour, so I think I'm just going to head back to Majula, drop another level... and shortly thereafter, we will call it a day. Bearer, seek, lest. That last precious point of strength. Well, nowhere near the last. We're going to be getting a lot more strength over the course of the game. But the last that we need in order to use our bastard sword, so let's put that on right now. Alright, that's a good loadout, that is. Let's take a look at the moveset. A little slower than the straight sword, but... nice big wide swings, and a nice vertical chop followed by a spinning slash with the R2 button. I like big weapons in Dark Souls 2. That's why I usually roll with strength builds. And now let's see, we've got a couple of consumables here. Maybe it'll be enough to buy that shield. Let's find out. And if it's not, at least it'll be enough for another level, I imagine. But I think that's going to be just enough. Hey, Mullen.
Oh, hello again. I hope you find something of use.
Yep, just enough.
Thanks very much. And do please come again.
Rest assured, I will be back. Because at the very least, we're going to spend enough money with Mullen to see the rest of his inventory. Alright, let's take a look at that new shield. The Twin Dragon Great Shield is a wooden great shield featuring twin dragons, as the name implies. Quite light for this size of shield. One requires strength to handle a great shield, but they are very stable. In battle, one fights using shield bash instead of parrying. So that's going to put us over 70% of our equipment load, which means we are now cursed with the fat roll. I don't really care for the fat roll, so let's see if we can shed a little weight from our armor. I want to keep on the item drop hat, but what else have we got here? The imported tunic will drop us a little, but not all that much. This glove will obviously have less defense, but it'll drop us more substantially. Hey, if we take the hollow soldier leggings, we will still be fully dressed, but we will be under 70%, and that means we have our nice normal roll. I think it's a fair bargain. Of course, it does mean we'll take a little more damage from being hit, but hey, we'll just have to try even harder not to get hit at all. In any case, I think that's enough for one day. It's actually been a pretty good session. I'm in a slightly better mood, and I hope you've enjoyed the trip as well. It's been a pleasure, folks. This is Un, and I'll see you again next time. Ta! A big squishy heap of gratitude, as always, to my generous supporters, such as Justin Carpenter, Nolden, Zangamarth, Charlie Dunst, Anonymous Benefactor, John Madigan, Johnny Millennium, Sanguine Games, Joseph Coco, Misha Van Doren, Craig Patterson, Frank Grizzy, Tim J., Lolo DePuzzlo, Joshua C. Ritchie, Jared C. Rice, Darren Chow, Sonic Rose, and EX Potemkin. Thank you as well to all other patrons, and all watchers, subscribers, and commenters. I am very glad to have you along, and I hope to see you next episode. Till then, have a good one.